Azadiye bayan.
Yanglun zuyou.
Free speech. Thanks very much, Jim. And thank you, colleagues. Hard to know where to start with my opening remarks, but maybe appropriate, Tim, just to say I looked at the title of the talk and thought, well, actually, in my view, Rhodes has fallen, and I weed on his grave in the Metopus. The important thing about that statement is that a lot of the Rhodes Must Fall campaign, I think, is locked, unfortunately, into a question about the psychology of colonialism. It's important, perhaps, for me just to say a little bit about myself. I'm now, of course, I'm British, but I was, some many moons ago, a student leader in South Africa at the University of Wits. And I was banned and put under house arrest for 5 years for my political views. I was also detained under the Suppression of Communism Act and the Writers' Assembly Act and spent time in prison throughout every one of my 4 years at university for being a believer in free speech and willing, of course, to do two things. One, to fight for it. So I led the student movement, the tearing down of the South African Republic Day flag, and which is one of the reasons I was banned, for leading student movements in the country to speak out against the apartheid system, and particularly in education. But the one thing about that lesson, right, so the Rhodes Must Fall campaign is not a new campaign. It is a... But this is what saddens me. One should have been able to see it as a continuation of a student struggle against protracted issues. Of course, apartheid has fallen in South Africa and Zimbabwe was liberated in the 1980s. But to understand Rhodes Must Fall today means that we need to understand the history of the struggle for... against oppression and for freedom in South and Southern Africa. I think one of the lessons I learned as a student leader at the of the time, that there were, of course, student issues at the University of Wits or Cape Town or elsewhere. And as I said before, we weren't scared to voice our objection to this. But the objection was always carefully linked and associated with the national struggle for freedom and liberation. It wasn't an isolated struggle. And this is what saddens me about Rhodes Must Fall, in that it taking down a statue is neither here nor there. I don't think that really is the issue. I think the issue is... The statue, of course, symbolises something. In my view, it symbolises, for many people, it symbolises a kind of psychological weakness. Why would a statue, whether it is in Cape Town or in Oxford, be such a powerful reminder against colonialism when we have other symbols in the men and women who have fought throughout Southern Africa for liberation. I mean, the national liberation movements in Zimbabwe, ZANU and ZAPU, when Mugabe came to power in 1980 and Joshua Nkomo, of course, having fought those particular struggles, were focused on much bigger issues. When the African National Congress, perhaps the oldest national liberation movement on the continent, formed in 1912, could have chosen so many different symbols against colonialism, Rhodes being one of them. Clearly, there isn't anyone in those national liberation movements who would for one moment have thought that Rhodes wasn't anything but a loathsome colonist, robber, and downright scoundrel. But that wasn't the focus. The focus was on bigger things. So I suppose what I really want to say is, it would be almost disingenuous of me to say that I don't sit back and actually think very highly of students involved in the Rhodes Must Fall campaign, struggles against apathy and lethargy, and it's a wonderful movement. But I think it's slightly misguided, I'm afraid, misguided in the sense that it has become divisive in Oxford, but principally it's become divisive in South Africa. Many of my friends in South Africa are vice-chancellors of universities, none who speak very highly of the Rhodes Must Fall movement, because they've been involved, as many others have been, for years and years, trying to dismantle the histories of apartheid and to build universities and places of learning that justify the struggles of those that have gone before them. The student campaigns in Cape Town and elsewhere in South Africa under the Must Fall label have been divisive. They've not aligned themselves to very much of a national character of struggle. They've divided communities, they've divided academic communities, they've separated lecturers from students, they've separated black students from black students. So I won't go much further, but I think to understand the movement and where it needs to go is perhaps to understand the history of the liberation struggles in South Africa that have never been monolithic campaigns, that have been campaigns of black liberals against black radicals, that have been campaigns that have ultimately been won by those who had a much broader sense of the political strategy and political tactics to overcome the bigger enemy, not the smaller.